Good day and welcome to this service this morning. The service, the 12th Sunday after Pentecost, August 23rd. Just a few brief announcements. This is kind of a strange one, but when you're hearing this, the diaconate met last week, but we haven't met yet because this is still a week ahead. So we'll have some report on that, probably getting out maybe in the weekly update, and we're hoping to get some stuff together so we can actually open up and gather again, maybe initially in the courtyard, but we'll have some results of that at the diaconate meeting, which actually meets today, which is a week ago when you're hearing this. So anyway, and also the other news is coming up, the diaconate retreat. The news has gone out for that. It'll be held August 24th, which is a Monday, from 9 to 11. And that'll be here in Hausman Hall. At that time, the diaconate will vote on the slate of officers. Normally, I'd be warning this in August for a church-wide congregation vote, but our bylaws don't quite handle this current situation. I'm not quite sure how to handle it either, so we'll just stay updated on how we do that election. The next thing are we are collecting the hygiene kits. I believe that the missions department is going to purchase some extra supplies, and at some date coming up, they'll have an assembly gathering here to put together some more, but we have got a number of them already collected that people have done at home. And just some local concerns and maybe even a little wider spread. Just remember all of those in those areas in Colorado that are affected by wildfires. We've known this was coming. It's been a very dry year. So, and they're flaring up all over the place. And also just remember a little further fire, the explosion and those that were injured in Beirut, Lebanon. At this time, we'll have our prelude. Thanks to David.
Thank you. Whoops. That's never happened before. Still caught on it. Good morning, my friends. It's good to be with you today. Today we are doing worship a little different. We're trying to get prepared for when we actually start coming back into worship. We're trying to shorten the service some for those. We recognize that an hour service online for those that are watching it online is awfully long, and we've been told by health people that when people do start coming back, we need to kind of shorten the service a little so that our exposure isn't so great. So we're going to be for the next couple of weeks kind of tweaking this service some, just to kind of let you know that. As well, it's great to have David back, and Katie's going to be singing for us. Meister Eckhart, a German theologian in the Middle Ages, kind of known as a mystic, he once wrote that if you only have one prayer to share with God, you could not do, thank you, Lord, is enough. Thank you, Lord, is enough. So today we simply say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this church. Thank you, Lord, for our gathering. Thank you, Lord, for your grace in our lives. Let us hear this special music today, How Great Thou Art.
Oh, Lord, my
Thank you, Katie and David. And it is, just for the few that are here, it is good to applaud every once in a while, especially after a wonderful rendition of that classic hymn. Our scripture this morning is taken from Luke 10, verses 25 through 37. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. He said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." He said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell in the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was the neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise."
Thank you, Norm. I remember a book that I had when I was a child. It was a book called Tell Me Why. It was really, as a child, it was one of my favorite books. Its pages were full of colorful illustrations and hundreds of short answers to questions that inquiring minds want to know. Questions like, what are freckles, and how do spiders spin their webs, and are there really such things as vampire bats? Now I love that book. Those are good questions, aren't they? When you study the Gospel of Luke, you discover that Luke is kind of like that little book that I had as a child. It is almost as if Luke makes a list of questions that people have about Jesus, and then using the life stories and the teachings of Jesus, he tries to answer them. Questions like, who can be saved? Why did Jesus drink and eat with tax collectors and sinners? By what and whose authority is Jesus acting? Like my Tell Me Why book, I suspect that Luke scribbled down the questions that he thought most people would have, and then he tries to answer them throughout his book. And today's story, the parable of the Good Samaritan, records one of the most famous questions of all. The passage begins with a lawyer who stands to test Jesus. Now, notice from the very beginning that this is a test. Why does Luke tell us that this questioner is testing him or testing Jesus? Well, perhaps this lawyer wants to know if this Galilean named Jesus does in fact have the wisdom that his followers claim that he has. So Luke presents an intriguing scene. Luke has us picture this attorney standing up and facing Jesus, perhaps with an arched eyebrow. "Excuse me, Rabbi, excuse me, but I have been studying for the bar exam here in the state of Galilee. And when I get to the section on law and eternity, there's one question that stumps me every time. What must I do to have eternal life? You know, it is a big question. Many people of faith consider it to be the biggest of all questions, the most important of all questions. You could not ask a more important question. What do I need to get my name written in that little book and hear Peter say, when I reach the pearly gates, what do I need to hear Peter say, come on up or come on in, not go on down, but come on up? What things must I accomplish to merit a hand-inscribed invitation to heaven? It's one of those type of fundamental questions that you would expect a good rabbi or perhaps a good preacher to have a ready pat answer for. But instead of a well-honed response, instead of handing the attorney a neatly tidy list of the top 10 things that you have to do to inherit eternal life, Jesus turns to the lawyer and puts two questions back to him. What is written in the law, and what do you read there? And immediately the encounter changes. Now the lawyer is the one on the spot. Suddenly he's the one being tested. The answer to your question, Jesus says, is in the Holy Scripture. Surely you've been studying the Torah, the law, in your classes. What do you find there when you read it? At this abrupt turn of the conversation, I imagine the attorney pausing a little and mentally thumbing through the text in his mind that he's committed to heart. If so, his study has paid off. For the lawyer swiftly responds that brings together two important themes of the law of Moses. Love God, love your neighbor. Good answer, Jesus says. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, all your strength and all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. You've mastered Old Testament Torah 101. You get an A. Love this way, Jesus says, and you shall live. This could easily have been the very end of the story. And it would have been a good ending. The lawyer answered well, and Jesus sends him forth to live a life devoted to loving God and loving those around him. But it's not the end, neither for the attorney nor for us. You see, like us, this young attorney wants clarification. He must be a good lawyer. Contract law was probably the class that he excelled in most when he was in law school. And one thing about contract law is that it calls for precise language so that there is no doubt to the meaning. And so he says, Jesus, I need a little clarification here. Jesus, tell me, who counts? Who is my neighbor? That's a very broad question. Now, or broad word, neighbor. What do you mean by the word neighbor? Who exactly are you talking about? And it is almost as if the energy of the story picks up here. It is almost as if you can see a little smile come across Jesus' face as he turns his full attention to the young attorney and he says, who is your neighbor? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you a little story. I got a little story for you. And Jesus tells this story. A traveler was on his way to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers who beat him and left him for half dead along the side of the road. Now, by chance, a clergy person, a priest, happens to walk along the same road. And we think, good news, surely this guy is going to stop and help the injured man. And yet the priest, in catching sight of the bloodied man, chooses to pass by on the other side. And we think, huh, that's kind of strange. What type of clergy person is this? The story messes with our expectations. I mean, you would expect a man of the cloth to be the last person who would not stop and lend a helping hand. And then a Levite, another respectable religious leader. A Levite was kind of like the assistant to the priest. You see, any first century attorney would quickly recognize that the priest and the Levite in this parable are people who would have a deep knowledge of the law. Like the attorney, these were people who knew the law well enough to have the right answer come to mind when they were challenged and pressured. But they also knew the law well enough to make it work for them when they needed it. What does God's law say? What case has precedent here? In this story, a religious man finds a bloodied body lying on the side of the road, and what does he do? What does the law dictate for him to do? Well, there are passages in the law that does say we need to help our neighbors. The passages in the law of Moses that tell us to help people in need. But on the other hand, if you want to avoid the messy situation, you might also recall that there are verses of Scripture that instructs the priest to not approach a dead body. The 21st chapter of Leviticus, verses 10 and 11, the priest who is exalted above all others shall not go anywhere close to a dead body. The story tells us that the man was on the side of the road, left half dead. Perhaps he was laying there unconscious. If he wasn't dead already, he could die at any moment. From a distance, he probably looked as if he was dead. So the priest was just following the law. And the law was very clear. The priest shall not go anywhere near a dead body. Any questions? Any clarification needed there? The priest was doing what the law said for him to do. And as is so often the case, there is conflicting precedents within the law. Surely Jesus knows this. So he asked the attorney, "What do you read there?" I don't know, but perhaps, just perhaps, Jesus here in this story is reminding us that Scripture can sometimes be used to justify some pretty ungodly behavior. We are probably not surprised that he portrays the clergy person here as the culprit. Over the course of history, preachers have quoted the Bible to prop up slavery, to support racism, to unfair, unequal treatment of women, to bless the persecution of Jews, to discriminate against the LGBTQ community. Even today, you don't have to channel surf very long to find ministers who sprinkle their prescription for America with bits of Scripture that seems to justify all sorts of ungodly things. What is written in the law? What do you read there? These questions challenge us to give careful thought to how we read Scripture. All too often, we use verses of Scripture to license whatever benefits us or whatever justifies any fears that we may have. We appeal to the Bible to find Scripture, surprise, surprise, to find Scripture that supports our own perspective, our own political leanings, our own way of living, and yes, our own prejudices. These parables caution us. Just because you've got the good book, just because you have the Bible in your hand, doesn't mean that you have cornered the market on holiness or righteousness. Luke points out, even the devil can quote Scripture. American writer Harriet Doyle once commented that a good story is like discovering something that you didn't know you had lost. It's finding an answer to a question that you never asked. Perhaps this is what happened to the lawyer on hearing this story that Jesus tells. Like my Tell Me Why book, the lawyer came to the rabbi with one question, but he left with an entirely different question. What do you read in the law? How do you interpret? What is in your heart as you go to the holy text? Are you reading out of self-interest? Are you looking to locate the minimum requirements? If you are, then you're in luck, for a well-read person can use the Bible to justify all sorts of immoral actions. Heck, even if you wanted to, you could rationalize sidestepping an unconscious man on the side of the road. It's right there in Scripture. This, of course, brings us to the central figure of the parable. Jesus gives us a sketch of this third traveler by simply mentioning his nationality. He is a Samaritan. In other words, he was an outsider. Samaritans were far from they were on the wrong side of the track. They were unorthodox. They did not share mainstream Judaism beliefs about God. And so the next person we see jogging down the road is this foreigner who has strange understandings about God, strange theologies about God. There's no way he will feel a compulsion, religious or otherwise, to help someone in the ditch. And yet, Jesus tells us that the man is kind. Maybe he's not able to quote Leviticus at the drop of a hat, but he knows in his heart how to be hospitable. The stranger makes the journey from the right answer to the right action. And is it just me, or does it seem that he goes about this work of charity with a lightness of heart? You might even call it joy. Which of these three, Jesus asked the lawyer, do you think was the neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? The neighbor is the one who showed mercy, the lawyer says. Right answer. Again, right answer, Jesus responds. And then, extending a hand to pull the attorney from the bog of selfishness, Jesus says, go and do likewise. And the story finally ends. That's the end of the story, right? Or does it? We are left wondering, didn't Jesus just place the endless weight of servanthood upon the attorney? And with the attorney upon all of us who are overhearing this story? Well, yes. I guess being a good neighbor to people around us, to people in our city, to people who are homeless, to people who are suffering, there is a weight to that. Perhaps it could be described as a cross to bear. But if you stare at the attorney long enough, you may also see that Jesus blesses him and he blesses us by giving him and us a chance at a meaningful life, maybe even a life steeped in eternity. Go and do likewise. Show mercy to those around you. Amen. Today, we want to lift up in our prayers, continue lifting up in our prayers, Brett Abernathy, who's recovering and from that horrible accident. Jason, the 11-year-old boy who has been struggling so much. Alpin and Sue Rodman, who's still recovering from some issues. And Jean Bump, whose mother-in-law passed away at the age of 104. Let us keep them in our prayers. I invite you in your minds to reflect upon all others in our congregation who may be struggling or who may be rejoicing, and lift them up in your prayers as well. May the peace of God be with you. Let us pray. Creating and sustaining God, in whom we live and move and have our being, how small and insignificant we seem as we come before you. Yet, O Lord, we know that you care about each of us. We come to you as the God of light, praying that you may free us from shadows of doubt and darkness and despair. Brighten the corners of our minds that we might see miracles in otherwise ordinary events. Let us be amazed at the sound of children's laughter, the return of the smile to those who have grieved, the freshly straightened shoulders of those who no longer suffer the heavy burden of despair, the energized walk of those newly in love. O God of light, shine your ray of hope into our darkness, and let us see these miracles of joy anew. God of mercy, hear our prayers. We sometimes feel guilty for our many shortcomings. We want to be better people. Grant us your grace to break any habit that keeps us from living up to the potential that you have placed within us. O God of courage, this is a particularly frightening time. We have come face to face with just how vulnerable we are as a nation and as individuals and as a church. These times have escalated long-standing fears about illness and violence and racism, unemployment, and economic problems. These are frightening times, O God of courage. Let the truth of the gospel sink into our hearts and move us into a new way of thinking and into a new way of living. Oh God, remind us over and over again that there is nothing in all of your creation that will keep us from your love as shown to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Oh Lord, we lift up this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn today, our closing song that Katie and David are going to sing and provide the music for us, is a song of invitation. You are invited as you hear these words, as you participate in this music, you're invited to listen to where God is calling you. The call is an awfully big word. I like the word inviting you. Listen to where God is inviting you to be the hands and the feet and the voice of Christ in God's world.
Still on the roses and the voice.
And the people said, Amen.
Amen.
Whenever I hear that song, it reminds me of my grandmother's funeral. It was one of her favorite songs back in the 70s. I was just a kid. I was just in high school. But that was sung. Thank you, Katie. My friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you forever and ever. Amen.